Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Pastor.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Give him a clap offering this morning. Thank you, Jesus. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Move and minister in our midst today. We praise you for the folks that are here, Lord. The ones that are probably still on the way, and maybe still others that will be around the Lord's table with us toward the close of the service. Father, wherever we might be, you know where we are, even when we don't. Hallelujah. Thanks, Lord. Sometimes it's so dark, we don't even know where we're at, but you never leave us. You never forsake us. You always bring us out, and you never bring us out less. You always add. Hallelujah. Thank you for bigger, Lord. Thank you for better. Thank you for brighter. Thank you, Lord, for bolder. In your wonderful name, we give you praise today. Hallelujah.
God says yes, and I know that I'm blessed.
Yes,
got a heart that's at rest.
Yes,
and a future that's sealed.
Yes,
if I'm healed, then I'm healed. Not afraid of circumstances, 'cause I've already found the answers in Christ. All of God's promises are yes, yes and amen.
Yes,
and I know that I'm blessed. Got a heart that's at rest.
Yes,
got a future that's sealed.
Yes, if I'm healed,
then I'm healed. Not afraid of circumstances,
'cause
I've already found the answers in Christ. All of God's promises are yes, yes and amen.
Now's the
Thank you, Lord. Thank you that the enemy can't tamper with your promises. The enemy cannot break in, Lord. The enemy cannot steal. The enemy cannot cause anything that you've given us to rust or deteriorate. Thank you, Lord, that we're encrypted. We're dead, and our lives stand encrypted with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, we'll be manifested with him. Thank you, Lord, that we're sitting with you today in heavenly places, looking down on the one that thinks he's above us. Praise your Lord, your name, Lord, for placing your heel on his head. Thank you for embarrassing the enemy before heaven, earth, and hell 2,000 years ago, sealing his fate and his doom with your shed blood. Thank you, Lord, for opening the prison doors and releasing his prisoners. Thank you for moving on in and plundering his house. Thank you for dividing his spoil with your children and making him pay them back 7 times over what he stole. Glory be to Jesus. Thank you for a finished work, Lord, and a defeated enemy. Thank you for allowing us to rule and reign until every enemy of yours is a footstool for our feet. We love you, Lord. We thank you. We give you praise today. We give you praise today, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's wonderful. He's wonderful. Hallelujah. He's wonderful. Blessed be his holy name. Never late. Might be the 11:59 God sometimes, but he's never late.
I want to lift up your name.
just worship today. The Bible says the fear of man bringeth a snare. Paul said in the New Testament, Christ has made you free. Stop becoming slaves of men. What if I don't say, if I don't do, if I don't go, if I don't provide, what will they think? What will they say? What will they do? Who cares? Who cares? Only one person matters in the final analysis.
Oh,
Blessed be your holy name, Jesus.
Your heavenly, all these things.
Hallelujah.
We give them back to you.
Acknowledge
you as the maker. You are the maker.
And I want you happy with me, says the Lord. And yet some are disappointed. It is as if you have looked at me and looked to me and looked toward me and found me wanting. But I come behind in no gift, says the Lord. I come short of nobody's expectations. I do exceeding abundantly above all that you are able to ask or even think about. But it's according to the working of my mighty power, surging through your inner person, says the Lord. Can we blame the sun when the clouds obscure it? Is it not still shining? When the storms of life are raging in your life, says the Lord, am I not still upon my throne, ruling and reigning far above those trivialities that trip you up? If you would open the eye of your heart, open the eyes of your spirit, if you would look and lean not on the flesh, but upon my inner person, says the Lord, and rest your weary head upon my bosom, you would find the clouds departing. You would find the waves dissipating. You would find yourselves on a placid place in the midst of the storms of life, and you will testify that you're happy with me. With me, you have everything. Without me, you have nothing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, by your wonderful word, dispel the clouds that obstruct our view of you. Remove, Lord, wipe away that which man has placed in front of our spiritual eye. Remove, Lord, the lies we've been told about you. Silence the taunts and jeers of the enemy, Lord. Let us hear your sweet voice. Come unto me, all you who labor, having been heavily laden, and I will rest you. Learn from me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden light. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I hear the Lord sing that beautiful verse from John. Peace I give you, not as the world gives. My peace I leave with you, not as the world gives, not as the world imparts. Thank you, Jesus.
You're all we need, Lord.
In the world you'll have trouble, but cheer up. I've overcome the world. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. not your hearts be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Thank you, Jesus.
Our eyes are on you, Lord.
Those who wait on Yahweh will exchange their strength. They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They'll walk and never faint. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thanks for coming on out. Anybody sleep more than me? Everybody? Okay, good. Took a page out of a year ago or so. But the Lord gets us through, doesn't he? If you have questions on crowns, you lost your crown, you misplaced it, we'll tell you where to find it on Wednesday. Please come along. Lots of interesting stuff about crowns in the Bible. Might not be what we think it is, or they are. So we'll be here Wednesday, Lord willing, at 7:15. If you got some shakable change in your hand or your pocketbook, you can leave it in the pennies for heaven jar today. That'd be great. And happy birthday to the boy. He will be, well, I guess he gets inducted into the... what's that fella's name? The comedian.
Jack Benny.
The Jack Benny Club.
39.
For real. When we eat, sometimes we say something along the lines of, someone will, she'll say, who is this? I said, my brother, you know. I can't be old enough to have a kid that old. Wow. That's old enough to know better, isn't it? Wow. Mm. Gee whiz. Anyway, happy birthday to Solomon in advance. Maybe we'd have a shout out at him on Wednesday, day after. See if he survived. If you have your Bible with you, turn to the book of Proverbs, chapter 12. This verse was kind of in the back of my mind, and then it came up in my daily Bible reading not too long ago, and I thought, okay, that does it. We better look at this in some detail, and I think it's going to be worth our while. The Bible study is on the subject of up from the depths. Some of us find ourselves there, unfortunately, more often than we'd like. But we want to come up and out. Amen? Amen? If we're down, we want to be up again. Circumstances, pressures of life are sometimes like a big thumb on a cork in a barrel of water. I'm trying to push you down, you know, but the Lord has a way of moving that thumb. Amen? And then we rise to the top again. Proverbs chapter 12 this morning, verse 25. Lots of truth here regarding coming up from the depths. This is the wisest man that ever lived apart from the Lord Jesus. He walked his talk. He knew what he was saying, not just from revelation from heaven, which he had plenty of, but also from life experience. Nothing like that. Amen. I don't like to take advice about a car from someone whose own car is up on blocks. How about you? I like to know that the thing works. Proverbs 12:25. Heaviness in the heart of a man maketh it stoop, but a good word maketh it glad. I'm reading from the King James. I don't know what version you have. Heaviness in the heart of a man maketh it stoop, but a good word makes it glad. I had a prophetic word from the Lord one time. I'd been doing a lot of counseling, and Boy, it really resonated with me. And the more I think about it, the more I think of all the people that I have ministered to, one on many or one on one, that have been beaten, bruised, and battered by life, that are like that man in Christ's parable who was lying on the street, sighing, crying, dying because of what life had done to him. I was thinking about all of that, and I felt like the Lord gave me a little prophetic word. And he said this to me, just because somebody uses a trumpet for an ashtray doesn't make it an ashtray. That'll preach. Just because someone out there uses a trumpet for an ashtray doesn't make it an ashtray. And I'll add something to what the Lord told me, if you don't mind. And I wager that there are still plenty of beautiful songs to be played by that trumpet. Amen? We just have to get ourselves in line with God's wonderful word, and we'll find the dawn of a new day. What you have in this one verse of Scripture is something very, very beautiful. First, the cause and effect. The cause and effect primarily of words, as we're going to see. And then the cure and the catharsis, or the change in our character that comes from being exposed to this word and having a close look at it. Here's the cause of the effect, which is being in the depths, in the pits, as they used to say. Here's the cause. Worry in the heart of a man will be weighing it down. Other versions have it, care in the heart of a man boweth it down. Grief depresses the heart. An anxious heart is dispiriting. You know, this word, worry or heaviness in the King James, means anxious care. Anxious care. It was used in the Old Covenant of someone being forced to fear an idol that they were being forced to worship. It had to do with sorrow on the sea regarding a city that was under siege by a foreign power. And Ezekiel used it of people who were eating their food with fear. Ever seen anybody eat with fear? Ever see a little sparrow or a little squirrel eating with fear? They look both ways, and they chomp, 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 and look both ways. It's like, this might be my last meal, so I better make her good. I almost bumped into a little sparrow on the way here this morning, and what do you think he was doing? Pecking at something that someone had left on the driveway, and I thought, you little rascal, and I slowed down. He took off, and you better believe he circled, came right back to it. But he wasn't really enjoying it, I don't think, like he'd like, because you never know when the next car is going to come and cut your lunch short. In the New Testament, we have some fascinating insight along the same line regarding what life can do to the heart or the spirit of a person, namely weigh it down or cause it to be bowed down or depressed or to cause a person to lose spirit. It's from his letter to the Ephesians and his other letter to the Colossians. Paul writes this to fathers or authority figures in Ephesians 6:4. Fathers, stop provoking your children. The idea is to anger. Here's the picture. A father, a parent, an authority figure, irritating, aggravating, upsetting a child by changing the rules or by what he or she says, like pushing a little dog into the corner and continuing to menace it and menace it and menace it. And what happens eventually, that fear and anxiety morphs and changes into anger and sometimes strikes out at the very person or the very object that's causing the distress. That can happen to children. Did you know that? The parallel account in Colossians is very interesting. Colossians 3:21. Stop inciting your children, again, to anger, watch this, in order that they do not become dispirited. You think about your relatives, your family members, your extended family members, people you do business with, kids you teach in school, or people that you hang out with who have children that have gone off on the wrong path. Why did it happen? Here's the answer. Stop inciting your children to anger in order that they be not disheartened. Another version has it, of a desperate mind, lest you make them spiritless. Why doesn't he get off his lazy bones and get a job? Why doesn't she get out of that house and start making her place in life? They seem to be spiritless. They seem to be disheartened. They seem to be weighed down in such a way that there's no life energy. How did they get that way? This word disheartened is a beautiful word. It's full of meaning. Athymosin, which means, you put an A in front, alpha, and the second word is thymos, and thymos is passion. It's drive. It came to mean anger. We're talking about some emotional energy that'll get you somewhere, that'll give you the strength to pop somebody on the nose or bash into the back of their car. That's what thymos is. It's a powerful energy. And the Bible says if parents or authority figures constantly keep a child under duress, they will eventually have that child morph from just afraid of them to angry at them, and they'll strike out either at the object or source of the problem or something or someone else. And I got to tell you, friends, fear and anger are two expensive emotions. They burn up a lot of life energy. Some people have no energy to move forward in life because they're out of spiritual gas. Why? They're always on a slow burn. I don't know about you, but I can tell that from a person very often just by watching them, just by looking at their affect, their face, their countenance, listening to their words, especially watching their eyes. Two different television programs, my testimony, not yours, two different television programs, I've seen the stars up close and personal as I watch, and I'll say to Barb, I wonder who that guy is angry at. He's not playing an angry character. It's the actor maybe laughing or smiling or joking, but the eyes are the window to the soul. And I ask myself, what's that young fella angry about? Who's he upset at? This is the state of many young folks. This second text that I mentioned, Colossians, Father, stop provoking or inciting your children to anger in order that they be not dispirited or disheartened or of a desperate mind. There's another word in another text under that translation, and that word means to irritate, to provoke, or to embitter. How many of you know children that are still not talking to their parents after 10, 15 years because of something went down when they were children, when they were young? Now that they're adult children, they'll walk a country mile to avoid crossing paths with their parent or whoever the authority figure was. Can I tell you something? There's a higher hint here, as I mentioned. Fear is often behind anger, and both fear and anger can cause depression. You and I, if we're constantly anxious, even on the subconscious level, or constantly angry, even on the subconscious level, or a bit of both, are like a tire with a small pinhole in it. And sooner or later, that tire gets flat. And that's really all in the world depression is. It's a spiritual, emotional, psychological flat tire. That's why sleep is so important for people that are depressed, that are in the depths, that would like to come up and out of it. That's why rest is often so important. What's the effect of worry, of care, of anxiety in the heart? What's the effect of it? It causes it to be weighed down. Now, I couldn't believe this. I looked this word up, and if you study the Hebrew word behind weighed down, make it that stooped, King James, you'll find almost uniformly in hundreds and hundreds of Old Testament texts, this word has to do with worship. Bowed down, weighed down. It has to do with worship. And the picture is somebody willingly bowing down in front of a God that they love. Isn't it amazing? And yet this reads, anxiety in the heart of a man will be weighing it down, making it stoop. What's the difference? When you and I worship God, there's no angel behind us cranking our arm up behind our back and saying, you better worship or else you better sing a little louder or you're going to the hot place. No, we desire to do it. It's a response of gratitude for all that God is and all that he's done, right? But when you're forced to, it's something different. I studied a number of different martial arts, and maybe you've been to a martial arts class and you've seen the students line up, and then you see the sensei walk in, and what will they do? They'll bow. To this day, if you're a martial artist and you'll know another person that's a martial artist, and if he's above your rank, you ought to do that. It's a display of humility. You bow. I'm a lower belt, lower rank than you are. Nothing wrong with humility, is there? Doesn't a lot of American culture need a good dose of humility? We've gone so far on the self-made man deal that some of us wouldn't even remember how to bow, you know, or show any kind of humility at all, and it shouldn't be that way. Almost uniformly, this word means to worship either an idol or the one true God. Doing obeisance to someone by choice, though. What's the problem with this verse? This is happening to us, and it's not by choice. We're being made to bow down under the weight of ceaseless anxiety and or anger. How sad. This is something happening to us by something coming from the outside, and that something is normally words. Boy, I found this interesting this morning. I looked up the Greek version of this in the Old Covenant. I always do that if I think about it, if I remember. I mean, after all, our New Testament is built on the Greek version of the Old Covenant. The Greek version is the one the disciples and the Lord Jesus used. So it never hurts to look at the one they were reading when some text comes up for discussion. And I did that. And the 70 has this translation of the Hebrew original. A terrifying word will be troubling the heart of a righteous person. Wow. A terrifying word. What's a terrifying word, Pastor? Well, let's say you just left the store and you feel the cold barrel of a gun in your ribs and you hear someone's voice saying, "Stick 'em up." That is a terrifying word. One of our members had that experience happen to him. It's one of my martial arts students back when we had the martial arts classes downstairs. And he came and testified, and we talked and demonstrated, you know, what we had learned from Sensei Joe and from what Aiki Jitsu has to teach about these things. And obviously, that was the first thing that came to his mind. And, you know, how to disarm somebody that's got a gun on you, whether in front or beside or behind, whatever. And he said all that went through his mind in the dark of night, several of these guys behind him. And you know, he could feel the gun. I don't think it made him happy. I don't think he was jumping for joy. He couldn't turn the television off or stop the Blu-ray, you know, or punch it to the next scene when the guy's okay, you know. He was just in the thick of it. And he said, clear as a bell. He said, I knew what I would ordinarily do. He said, it was the voice of God that was so clear. Take off running as fast as you can. He said, in the natural, it made absolutely no sense, especially at that close range with someone having a gun on you. He said, but I knew the voice of God and I didn't pause. I took off. He said, they didn't move. I ran. I looked over my shoulder. They were still there in the distance behind me, looking at each other with their guns. They didn't know what to do. How do you think he felt then? What made the difference? It wasn't the voice that said, give me your money. It was the voice that said, in his case, run as fast as you can, even though it goes against everything you know in the flesh, everything you've learned in all those hours of throwing people and being thrown and disarming people, even though it goes against conventional wisdom, the voice from a higher place, like angel dust, came down. I feel like I slept 12 hours now. Isn't the anointing wonderful? It was like angel dust, and he heeded that word. What caused the anxiety? Words. What dispelled the anxiety? Words. Oh, they're powerful. They're powerful. I remember my dad very seldom drank, very seldom. I think he was under the influence, I would call it, maybe twice I can remember. Oftentimes it would be around New Year's or a holiday. And then if he did have too much, which was extremely rare, he would then sometimes not exactly act out, but
be a different self, a different dad, and he would cry, and a lot of times he would talk about World War II, and he would start naming people, his close friends, that had died next to him, and this and that. It was a very sad thing. I don't remember a lot of it, but I remember occasionally. But I remember on one occasion, he was half in the bag. It was very unusual. I was just a little boy, and I don't know what he was mad about or what was on his mind or who had told him what, but I remember it like yesterday. He came into the hallway and he said something to my mom about, you better stop this or start the other or whatever, pointed at me. He said, or I'm going to throw both of you. I'm going to kill both of you. And, you know, he looked at me, said, I'm going to take that bed of yours and throw it out the window with you in it. You don't forget things like that. I got to tell you, I was not eased to sleep, you know, and that was the good part. Now, some of you know, the preacher is right. If you can survive your family, you're winning. I could tell you things about people's families that I've heard in counseling over 44 years of ministry that would give some of you girls a permanent without going to the hairdresser. But what was it? Words. Words and the pictures that they drew in my heart. So this is something very important, isn't it? A terrifying word will be troubling the heart of even a righteous person. Here are some facts about people down in the depths of despair. Did you know that some 350 million human persons suffer from depression today in our current age, with all that we have available to us by way of cure and by way of comfort? 350 million. Did you know that 11% of human persons have an episode of depression before the age of 18. Yeah, before the age of 18. Women are 70% more likely to suffer from ongoing depression than men. 70% more likely. 30% of college students testify they have had a period of significant depression while going to school. And think about this, 50%, one out of two persons who are suffering from being in the depths of despair, depression, one out of two, 50% never seek treatment. That's that person that looks kind of funny that you buy your groceries from. That guy that works on your car always has that unusual look on his face, always seems preoccupied. One out of two people you and I deal with that have depression are not being treated for it. What's the cost? In this country, $80 billion a year. $80 billion to deal with depression. And where does depression come from? Worry in the heart of a person, it will be weighing it down. Care in the heart of a man bows it down. Grief depresses the heart. An anxious heart is dispiriting. And some of that comes from fear-inducing words, anger-inducing words. Some of it comes from other causes. Some of it's even physical. Minority of the cases, it's actually a physical problem. How many believe we need to get out of this? These folks need help. They need a hand extended to bring them up out of the depths and get them back on track and running the race. Amen? Too many people that you and I know have been used by life, even though we're musical instruments, we've been used as an ashtray. Here's the good news. We've got some beautiful songs to sing and to play yet. Amen. You want to move from the cause and effect to the cure and the catharsis, the change in character? I do. Here it is. Proverbs 12:25. But a good word. It will be causing it to rejoice. That's what it reads. But a good word, the word will be causing the heart to rejoice. Just like the cause, the cure comes from outside of us. It comes from out there. Really, it comes from up there in a perfect world. It comes, we need higher help. This problem can't be solved on its own level. That voice has got to come from where our church member heard it when he was under the gun, literally. It has to come from outside us. Just like the cause, the cure comes in the same way. Normally in a perfect world with words. Did you know when parents or authority figures speak negatively to a child, you'll never amount to anything. Oh, you did it again. You idiot. I told you not to play with that. You broke it. Now what am I going to do? It takes 17 good words to that child to make up for one negative. 17. Think about that. You wonder why you feel the way you do. I wonder why I'm the way I am. We wonder why folks around us are in the depths of despair. Here's the good news. You and I don't have to do anything about this. We just have to hear and heed the word when it comes. You know, my friend from church didn't have to call a committee meeting with his family members. Well, I wonder what I ought to do. Should I do what I was taught to do in martial arts class, or should I do what I heard from upstairs? Didn't have to think about it, just had to act on it. He didn't have to drum it up. Aren't you glad about that? I am. God's got this word. He's ready, willing, and able to deposit it in our heart. And when it comes, all we have to do is receive it. Praise the Lord. I like easy. How about you? I came out of the womb lazy. I think when I kick off, someone else is going to have to cross my arms over my chest. You do it. You know. You're the nurse. That's what they're paying you to do. Why don't you cross your own? I'm too tired. You do it. Yeah, this is good news, isn't it? Just recently, a couple of Wednesdays ago, some of you that were here, many of you were not, but it was an interesting experience. Service is over, just about closing things up Wednesday night. Barb comes through the rear doors. She said, I have an emergency prayer request. Well, obviously you stop. I said, what's going on? We're almost done. We can pray. What's going on? I lost my wallet. Had all the credit cards, everything in it. Wow, I was fixing to get gas, you know, and I can't find it anywhere. Do you think that excited me? Was I thrilled? Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so glad. I'm so glad this is in some stranger's hands now, and we have some joint accounts, you know. We've been together for over 40 years. We figured we should get married. We just did. No. And I'm thinking, this is not it. Not cool. But that was the terrifying word. It did not cause my heart to rejoice. And I thought, But I dialed it back a notch. You can't be a Christian for over 40 years without learning some things by accident. I knew enough to stop, look, and listen. I didn't wave a flag. I'm stopping, I'm looking, I'm listening. I'm practicing what I preach. No, I just, in myself, I just dialed it back a notch and looked to the Lord. Remembered 1 Corinthians 10:13. That's my hobby horse. I've got a couple. That's one. No temptation, test, or trial overtaken you. Was I looking for it? No, neither were you looking for what put you in the depths of despair, but it came anyway, didn't it? No temptation, test, or trial overtaken you, but such as is common to man. God's faithful. He won't allow you to be tempted, tested, or tried above your present level of ability. You don't ask a new Aiki student to do a form that's 8 places up beyond where he is. Never. You test him where he is. Right along with the temptation, test, or trial, provide an alternative outcome so you can carry away something you wouldn't have had any other way. My paraphrase. And I said, Holy Spirit, you know where that is? You know what's what? Thank you. This surprised us, but it didn't surprise you. I want your way out. Not mine, not Barb's, not the enemy's. Yours. Wasn't within 45 minutes, she texted Solomon. My wallet was still in the Durango between the seat and the door. Never even left her presence. How do you think I felt when I heard that word?
Very joyous.
Yeah. Didn't take 30 years to come up out of the depths, did it? Is this helping anybody? Or did I waste my time? The same vehicle, human persons, who can hurt with what David the psalmist said, with tongues like swords can also heal a wounded heart. I mentioned the other day that I was athletically challenged as a young person, and I was taught that I was, uncoordinated, et cetera, et cetera. Long story short, I took a 3-month class in martial arts between 8th grade and high school. And during that 3-month summer course, one of the instructors said, you know what, son, he said, I may never see you again, but I think you should do this. You should learn this. You should keep on going. And then years later, I took my second martial art with Solomon. And I was just one belt before black, I think. And my instructor, a beautiful Korean gentleman, asked me if I would consider teaching a branch class out of the church I was pastoring at that point. what? Fast forward years later, studying yet another martial art. When I did the black belt test, Sensei Joe gave me the diploma. And also, I said, what's the second piece? He said, well, look at it. It's a certificate to teach. And they gave my goosebumps. I was talking to him the other night. I did a sword class under him with Solomon. And I'm left-handed, but I didn't want to take it left-handed and be an idiot and look out of place with everybody else. So I thought, I'm going to try doing it right-handed. I can't do anything with my right hand. But I did. I did it anyway. And I remember one night, we had to do a particular form, and I did it. He's watching different ones. He comes by me. I said, what? He said, you know, I can't think of a thing wrong with that form you just did. And it was like my goosebumps. I floated on that for months. I thought, man, somebody who knows more about it who's forgotten more than I know, what caused the two different attitudes toward myself? Words. Words of little kids, words of other people brought it down. Words from somebody else brought it up. How many are glad that words can change your life? Why are they so powerful, Pastor? Why? Why are they so powerful? Job 26, verse 4. He looks at his comforters, and this is what Job says. To whom have you uttered words? Well, you, Job, are you deaf? And whose spirit came from you? Some people's words are motivated by the Holy Spirit. Some people's words are motivated by the unholy spirit. Oldest book in the Bible, Job 26, verse 4. Whose spirit came from you when you spoke to me that advice I didn't ask for? Fast forward to the New Testament. Peter says virtually the same thing to Ananias, that make-believer who was with the church but not actually of the church. And Peter brought him up short in Acts 5:3 and said, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? Where did the words come from that he was lying with? From Satan, according to Peter. The same Holy Spirit that you and I worship today can give you a word for someone else tomorrow. It'll take the place of the words that Satan's crowd have been speaking to him. The cure, a gentle word can cheer it, your heart. Another version has it, a kindly word. The 70 says, but a good message rejoices it. The wrong words, the wrong treatment can sadden you, can sadden me, can bring us into the depths of despair. But the right words can gladden you, can gladden me, can bring you and me up out from the pits of despair. Why? Because the Word of God, whether it's coming from the Bible or a sermon or coming through the mouth of a friend, has the power of its own fulfillment. This verse today is for both those who are hurting and those who want to be healing. The people who are in the depths, be asking God, God, give me a word to change things in my life. Give me 17 good words that I can make it. I can amount to something. I can do it. I can be, do, and have anything and everything you said in your word was mine. God, make it come home to me. Make it real. I've been used as an ashtray. I feel like I've still got some songs to sing and play. Lord, give me a word to confirm it. Give me a word, multiple words from multiple people inspired by the Holy Spirit that will take the place of those negative words that have gotten me into this mess I so desperately want out of. The one that's hurting needs to seek for that word. The one that would like to heal needs to simply give it. I wrote a little fiction book. I usually write fiction under pen names, but this one I wrote under my given name. Maybe some of you have read it. It's out of print now. It's called A Horse of a Different Color. It's written from the standpoint of a developing equine. And in that book, I mentioned the story. Perhaps you've heard it, but I quit with this. There was a little eagle egg left by the mama eagle. And someone found it. A Native American little boy found the egg. And he didn't want to see that not burst forth into what it was meant to be. So he tried an experiment, and he gave it to a hen, a mother hen, to nurse and to nurture. And as God's providence would have it, that mother hen adopted that little eaglet egg and brought it forth to life. And it grew up, that little eaglet, along with the chickens, its adopted family, and spent its whole life in the barnyard with the other chickens, doing what they did, talking like they talked, eating what they ate, until finally it moved into old age. And as an old eagle amidst the chickens it had been raised with, it looked up one afternoon and saw in the sky a bird it had never even dreamed of, just soaring through the blue sky. And the eagle said to his stepbrother chicken, "What on earth is that beautiful thing?" And his mate said, "Oh, that there, that's an eagle. But you could never be that." Think about it. All his life, he lived as a chicken, when all the while, he was an eagle. But he didn't know it, because no one told him. Father, thank you today that you've told us exactly who we are, sons and daughters of God. Thank you, Lord, that you have brought us to new life in Christ. Thank you, Lord, that you speak to us with thousands of good words in your word recorded in the Bible, that it's our pleasure and privilege to feed on any time we desire. Promises not to one particular Bible person, but to all believers that are ours as much as they are any other Christians in your world. Thank you, Lord, for brothers and sisters in Christ who have eyes to see and ears to hear when we're hurting, when we're coming up short, when we've found ourselves imprisoned in the depths of despair because of wrong words that were hammered toward us, that cause us to be on edge to the place where now we've got a mixture of fear and anger and sometimes strike out at innocent parties with the same kinds of negative words. Lord Jesus, thank you for these brothers and sisters that can make it right by seeing something in us that we haven't seen, by saying something to us that we've never heard. Father, thank you for allowing us to bring a change to someone else, to bring a good message, a good word in the place of those terrible words that have been said, so that fear can take flight, replaced by faith. Anger can leave, replaced by peace. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for sitting where we sit and living this life as a man. Thank you, Lord, for partnering with us in good times and bad. Bless those, Lord, in our fellowship and friends of our fellowship around the tri-state, across America, and all around the world, who pray, who attend, who support, who serve in various ways to make this miracle happen. Thank you, Jesus, for this lighthouse for the full gospel in this northwest area of the city. Thank you, Lord, for this place that trains up and sends out people with this good news gospel of grace and glory. Thank you, Lord, for putting in our hands all kinds of outreaches to foreign fields, allowing us, Lord, to put our arms around people all around your world. Bless, Lord, everyone involved with a harvest 1,000 times more than anything they've expended in your name. Bless us, Lord, as we come around your table this morning and feast, Lord, on bread from heaven. In Jesus' name we praise you. Amen.
if it's real, I'm gonna keep it alive. Cause the road is long. There are mountains in our way, but yet we'll climb still higher every day. Lord, lift us up where we belong.
Oh, yeah.
Where the eagles fly on a mountain high. Lord, lift us up where we belong. Yeah. Far from the world we know, where the clear winds blow. What it used to be. Stop living your lives looking behind.
'Cause all we have is you right now. And our lives are in you to find.
Oh, but
the road
is still so very long. Yes, there are mountains in our way, but we won't worry, 'cause with Jesus we'll climb higher every day.
Oh,
Lord, lift us up where we belong.
Oh,
where the sometimes, yes, we'll cry, but he'll wipe every tear from our eyes. Lord, lift us up, Jesus.
Yeah.
For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is being broken for you. Do this in the memory of me." And in the same way, he took the cup after the supper, said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in memory of me."
Hallelujah. Nothing wrong with being a chicken, but there is if you're an eagle. Amen. Bless the Lord. If you need prayer this morning, we're always here to join our faith with yours. So many miracles happen here. I had rather have one genuine miracle than millions of goosebumps and whatever. Sometimes what people call the move of God is a million miles from it. Wait till all the smoke and dust clears and the special lights are off. And what actually took place? Did anybody really get saved? Did anybody really receive the Holy Spirit with the Bible evidence? Were there any real healings actually taking place? It's usually smoke and mirrors. I'm sorry to say this to you folks, and it's getting worse all the time. It's the slick, the glitz, the glamour, you know, and you go behind it and you wait or you watch. I'll not call his name. Very well-known, so-called evangelist was in town years ago. One of our members went to the service, and I talked to her afterwards, and she said they spent 2 hours taking the offering at that meeting. 2 hours just to take the offering. She said there was all this fanfare, noise, and this and that, and special lighting. I said, did you see any miracles? She said, I didn't see anything. Nothing really that I could tell happened. How sad. How sad. What's a Bible revival? Anybody know? Visit Acts chapter 8. Look at what happened when Philip came to town. When he was done, Luke writes, and there arose great joy. How many think joy is enough? There arose great joy, in the way Dr. Luke wrote it,
in the city, that one. In other words, anybody and everybody, regardless of their religious background, knew there was something different about Samaria. Why? God's man had been there. God's spirit had been there. God's presence had saved and healed and delivered. And people were baptized in the Holy Spirit when Peter and John came. And the whole city was changed. That's the move of God. It's something you can actually observe and verify. And that's what we need so much more of today, don't we? You see little pockets of it here and there, but the true thing is very, very rare. And I'm speaking from a lot of experience. The real deal is very rare. I just found out recently, one of our friends of our fellowship, not a member yet, received the Holy Ghost here, and her little baby, how old is she, five? Her little girl received the baptism because her mother talked to her about it. Imagine a little five-year-old speaking in tongues. That's the real thing. Hallelujah. How many are glad for real? Give me the real thing, Lord. Give me the real thing. Yahweh, may he bless you and protect you. Yahweh, may he make his face shine on you and be gracious and merciful to you. Yahweh, may he lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his shalom. Amen. Amen. Get fitted for your crown on Wednesday. So please take it.